Good evening and welcome to the Schwab School of Music. On behalf of the Voice Area, I'm pleased to welcome you to Rebecca Manso's Master's Lecture Recital. My name is Dr. Joshua May, and I serve as her voice mentor and her studio teacher, and I'm happy to share this wonderful lecture with you all today. If you'll please welcome Rebecca Manso.
Some background information on the four last songs. He show in the late 30s and turned his attention to orchestral works. He referred to them as Handlingsübungen, or wrist exercises to keep himself limber. And his son, Franz, suggested that he consider writing songs again. It had been a number of years since he had written songs. The Opus 27 in particular, he wrote that as a wedding gift to his wife, for her time, very well-known soprano, Paulina de Anna. And the Opus 27 serves as a beautiful foil to the four last songs. It's also a set of four songs, and you see some of the same themes touched on. This idea of going hand in hand as a couple through life, experiencing the inner joys that you have with deep love. Also, the songs, the four last songs, they were composed in a different order than how they were actually published, and it's not really certain if Strauss actually intended for them to be a full set as it stands. In fact, the Hesse Lieder, which are the first three songs that are generally performed today, they were the only ones noted in the manuscript as being a set of songs. And actually, these last four songs are not his final composition. He wrote one more song called Malven, or Summer Roses, but he did not set that to orchestra. So the four last songs are originally composed for orchestra. So the poets of the four last songs, first we have Hermann Hesse. He was a romantic poet and novelist. He was originally from Germany and grew up in a missionary family and spent a number of years in Southeast Asia and India in his youth, which is reflected again in his works. He is often searching for spirituality, self-recognition, authenticity, and he was awarded a Nobel Prize in 1946. He also was an ardent anti-fascist, and that is why he immigrated to Switzerland during the rise of Nazism. The final song in the order in which the songs are composed or are sung today is by Josef von Eichendorff, Im Abendrot. And Josef von Eichendorff was also a very well-traveled person for his time. He was a widely known literary person, and a lot of his poems deal with wandering, nostalgia, the passage of time, one might note that Theodor Adorno said he was not a poet of the homeland, but rather of homesickness. And so this is particularly relevant in light of how also Strauss was perceived at the time of his death. He had been under a lot of criticism for his relationship for his actions during Nazism. We'll discuss that more in a moment. But I believe that Strauss chose this this poem more from the desire to deal with homesickness rather than something nationalistic. So now we get to the reconciliation part, and get to discuss some of the wonderful recordings that we have of these works. The Four Last Songs were premiered in 1950, a year after Strauss passed away. And he had sent the songs to the great dramatic soprano Kirsten Flagstadt, and asked that she premiere these songs and engage a first-rate conductor. She chose Wilhelm Furtwängler, who was also a very well-known conductor and highly regarded. And all three of these people, Strauss, Flagstadt, and Furtwängler, received a lot of criticism for their actions during the Third Reich, mainly because they elected to stay in Nazi Germany. And, Flagstadt returned to her home country, but she continued to perform to some degree in Europe during the war. And Strauss really perceived himself as a successor to German music, German high culture, and especially to Wagner. In having these figures perform this music, it is a form of reconciliation for these figures who stay behind to rescue their music, to rescue music from the fascists. And so we can be grateful that they premiered this music. Some other critical recordings that I personally recommend, Elisabeth Schwarzkopf and conductor George Zell, Gundula Janowitz and Herbert von Karajan, and then some more, in the 80s and 90s, we have Lucia Popp with Georg Solti and Lucia Popp and Klaus Tennstedt, as well as Jesse Norman and Fortnazor, last but not least. It's actually interesting to note, to listen to the Georg Solti recording with Lucia Popp, it is a very quick, the tempo is very fast in some places, and it's interesting because Georg Solti was actually responsible for coordinating Strauss's 85th birthday, so he would have known what Strauss's style really was like. We also have some orchestration considerations to look at. So, to inform us about what kind of soprano voice is best suited for these songs, we'll take a look at Elektra, for example. This is a very dramatic work. We have a very significant horn section, and also the percussion section is very heavy laden, as well as it's just a large orchestra, and it's a long sing for the soprano because she is on stage for the entire time after the first scene. So on the other end of the spectrum, we have his opera Ariadne auf Naxos, which is also generally cast with a very large lyric voice, or more often a dramatic soprano. And we have here a much smaller brass section. However, there is still a significant percussion section. And then right in the middle, we have the Violetta Liga. And we can see here that the brass section is significant, but it is not quite the dimension of Elektra. And then we only have just timpani along with the strings and other instruments. Finally, into this, we can draw a lot of inspiration from, or Strauss, better put, drew a lot of inspiration from his wife, the soprano, Paulina. And she retired fairly early from the opera stage, but the roles that she did sing were Agatha and Eva from Meistersinger and Elisabeth von Tannhäuser. All of these are large soprano roles. So now we get to listen to some recordings. And we have here in, so in his, in the, we'll discuss these songs now in the order in which the songs were composed. And the song Im Abendrot actually contains a citation from Strauss's tone poem Tod und Verklärung, Death and Transfiguration. The tone poem, this tone poem Strauss wrote when he was a mere 25 years old. So we'll take a listen. You have multiple pages leading up to the actual theme. It is echoed before that, but then at the highlighted place, it really comes out to bask in full glory. To escort her to the realms of death. And because she believes that Camus is coming. However, he's not. And then we'll listen to another comparison recording, just a snippet of Elisabeth Schwarzkopf singing Frühling.
Thank you.
be in the scheme of tiredness